And I also want to thank my class who has set up this room beautifully. It's amazing, and this is a new setup. I've never done it quite like this before. So I think that one of the things that's going to be really important is that we speak with some kind of voice, so that everybody can hear. And this is an experience that the audience is also part of, which is one of the reasons that the architects have constructed the site in this way. I think we're going to have to shut this door, or we're not going to be able to. We're going to get distracted. So I think I'll just start by, well, you guys were talking about something already. I mean, what were you talking about? I mean, it sounded like it was going. And maybe we should just let this go where you were going. What were you, I heard you were talking about Picasso. What did you say?
Oh, dear. Well, we started talking about reality.
Uh-huh.
Different kinds of reality, because that's part of Karen's work. And Karen asked, see, I was in the back seat. Karen asked Sheila if there were more truth in some artwork than others. And Sheila was having a very difficult time answering this. So it's as if she did want to say, go ahead.
Oh, no, it's very complicated. We had this can I back up just for a minute?
Yeah, please. Yeah.
In order to back up, however, I have to back way up, because what happened when the three of us started talking to each other, both over dinner and in the car, is that we discovered over dinner that Karen and I had some similarities in our constructs. Superficial, we're not sure how far those similarities go, and that's what we started to unravel in the car a little bit more.
And when you talk about your constructs, you
so I would like to turn it over to Karen, and she'll talk about hers, and then maybe I can talk about mine, and then we can start sort of see where we thought we had some similarities.
Okay, that sounds wonderful. I'm wondering if it might be helpful for the people here to hear, before we get into the idea of the constructs, if either I can or each one of you can talk a little bit about the nature of what you do, because I want to jumpstart it. At the same time, I don't want to jumpstart it so far that nobody else knows what's going on. So I'm trying to find a between place. So if I can do that. I know Karen, you're a physicist. You're a theoretical quantum physicist. I've been saying to people, she's this feminist quantum physicist who deals with the space between. And I always describe you with great fear, because I'm always afraid I'll say the wrong thing. Because but maybe you could talk. Maybe you could just give. I know when we were at dinner, you talked very briefly about what you're working on, and maybe that's can you do that?
I'll try to do it again. Probably comes out differently every time. I was talking with Sheila in the car, particularly about the way in which I'm trying to develop an ontology. It's very strange having people in my back. Physicists, in particular, a physicist named Niels Bohr, was struggling very much to understand quantum theory in a way that challenged traditional notions of ontology, that is, what exists in the world. And he struggled a lot with epistemological questions that are theories of knowledge about how we get to know and what we can know. And in the process of doing this, really turned upside down the Newtonian worldview. In particular now, physicists have actually experimental ways of answering a question that Sheila ironically had asked me just afresh in the car, which is about the moon, whether the moon has a position when nobody's looking at it. And actually, physicists now have a way of answering that experimentally, and the answer is no. And so what I have been trying to do in my own work is to understand Niels Bohr's epistemology, but to add onto it an ontology which is consistent with his theory. And I've come up with this notion which I call agential reality. And the agential part is an adjectival form of the word agency. And it comes from the fact that when we describe the world and when we know the world that we're knowing is not the world independently of us human beings, but it is a world that whose ontology is connected with the process of knowing. And therefore, there's agency involved in a sense of responsibility, in particular, both for the way in which reality comes from the between, and the way in which we know, and what kinds of questions we ask, and so on and so forth. Well, it turns out that my notion of agential reality that I've been struggling with quite a bit is very similar to Sheila's notion when and she was describing a particular art project that she's doing. So why don't you take it from there?
but before we do, could you just say your construct, because you had the knower, the elements in your agential model.
Oh, okay, yeah. So if I were to say, just because physicists said that if there was nobody around that the position, that the moon wouldn't have a position, that doesn't take away from the fact that position is still a very useful concept for some purposes. And we can even talk about the position of the moon in certain contexts. And what this would mean, though, is that when I talk about a notion like position, what I have to do is I have to say how I'm defining it. So I have to set up a particular experimental and conceptual apparatus. Okay, the conceptual apparatus gets materialized in a particular way with a particular setup, a particular apparatus of observation. And when I put all of that into place, if I want to talk about position, that's fine. I can go ahead and do that. But the referent for position is not the moon in and of itself. The referent is this very complicated object which has been formed, which is the moon plus the experimental apparatus plus the conceptual framework, which is historically, culturally, and otherwise situated. And that's what I mean by agential reality. So the referent is to this very non-local thing that is quite fluid and changing, and that it's not to, you know, the world as it exists independently of us human beings.
And what we found when we started talking is that I had discovered a construct in the early 80s, late 70s, that had to do with quite unexpected outcome of an art activity that I had done for about 6 years, in which I had a glass cube, and it was a dish. Actually, I got this dish quite surprisingly, in a surprising way, in the sense that in the early 70s, I went to a Japanese restaurant and ordered sushi, and the ginger came in this dish, and there I was, you know, in my early 30s, and I'm looking at this dish, and I'm thinking, I want this dish. I wanted to swipe this dish. I've never swiped anything in my life, and I really want to swipe this dish. And I didn't know why, and so I swiped it. And I took all the other ones on the table as well. And I didn't know why. I had to have it. And I have always discovered, whenever it's something so passionate that I must do it, no matter, I will, you know, die to do whatever it is, I've always found that that's been crucial in my life, like an important life direction. So that here was this dish. So I took these dishes home and put them on my shelf, had no use for them at all, but I wanted more. So I went back to the restaurant, and I didn't know why I wanted them, but I just did. I wanted as many, and of course they were all out. And so
everybody else is still.
So now I had these two dishes, and there was a moment when I couldn't think of anything to do in my artwork. So I took one of them into the dark room, and I started making photograms with them one day, and made 20 or 30, and thought I knew everything there was to know about this form, and quit. And then I, the next day, I thought, well, I want to make a couple of these again because I really like them. And I went to the dark room and started making photograms, and discovered not only I was not able to make the ones that I had done the day before the next day, but also I found brand new aspects of this dish on the photo paper that I hadn't imagined the day before. So I began to realize that I could go into the darkroom periodically with this very simple form, and it was like this process of consciousness. I would find new forms every time I would go into the darkroom, and I did this for years and did hundreds of them, and then I did them in different media. I did them in black and white prints and in color Xerox and in cyanotype and in computerized. I digitized one of the black and white ones at the USC School of Engineering Image Processing Laboratory and permutated color through the gray levels and made prints of that. And then I made a computerized film of color permutating and time. And then I x-rayed the cube, and I have mammograms of the cube, and so on and on. And it was sort of like I got into the idea of the infinite potential for form and nature, and that this was kind of this exploration of the potential for the simple thing to have infinite form. And I was in love with this idea. And so then I had the show at Los Angeles Municipal Gallery. And on one wall, there were hundreds of cubes. On another wall, there were four cyanotypes in the XYZ axis. Another wall, there were 16, a matrix of 16 from the computer. And I showed my film and my x-rays. And each of the forms had its own appropriate, each of the technologies had its own appropriate form based on its own language of translation of this cube. And each of the artworks were according to what I thought was the appropriate form. So then they wanted me to write a statement about what this was about. And I had no idea what this was about. I did not know why it was so interesting to me. And I realized, while I was thinking about what had happened now that I'm looking back on it at that time, was that it wasn't just about the cube, but there was another level to it that had to do with the social construct. And so I said, cubeness plus my mind plus whatever technology I have at my disposal resulted in these different artworks that were using these different technologies. But if I change the language from cubeness, if I say artness plus mind in culture, which is socioeconomic mind or gender mind, if I say that as mind rather than my mind, plus whatever technology that socioeconomic group has at its disposal at any historic moment, then I would be able to see what the idea of a relevant statement making at any historic moment would be for the various socioeconomic groups in culture at that time. So I could see what would be relevant, for instance, for the white people and black people and Latino and Asian people in a particular historic moment if I decentralize this idea of relevance and look at it from from the different perspectives. So I tested this out with an exhibition for the Los Angeles Bicentennial and had three curators from each of the ethnic communities go into each of the communities and select artists to submit a portfolio of work, and then all 12 curators curated through the show. So it was not a pyramidal curatorial mind, but a decentralized curatorial mind. And the exhibition we had at Los Angeles Municipal Gallery was an amazing example of a relevance for various people at the various cultures at this historic moment, at that historic moment, which was 1980. And so the paradigm that I developed was a non-pyramidal paradigm for relevance in history. And it doesn't have a fixed point in one mind as there isn't a fixed point like a moon. It was a relative meaning given a concept of art plus culture plus technology. And in that way, Karen's paradigm and my paradigm overlapped in terms of the emphasis being placed on the relative positioning of consciousness rather than the location of it outside of the minds producing it.
So I want to break it down just a little bit, because it's so clear in your mind, and I'm
not very clear.
It's clear, but there's places where I'm struggling, and I'm wondering if anybody else is struggling too. In a sense you're making this a field of cultural relevance as the end product of the. As the goal of what you're doing. Is that the end part of the equation?
What happens is, in the sense that you can't look at a historic moment pyramidally and know anything about it in truth. You have to look at it in terms of the spectrum of things that people actually do, and then you understand the reality from a variety of perspectives.
Let me see if I can keep restating and see if I can, So in other words, you're looking at, as an artist, you're looking at the world and saying, how do I construct zones of cultural relevancy, which is maybe another. And am I correct so far or not?
I'm not trying to construct zones of cultural relevancy. I'm trying to recognize the existence of them.
Okay.
But through a lateral viewing of.
Okay, and why are you looking for those zones of cultural relevancy?
Because I think that unless I acknowledge a multiplicity of views, I don't adequately understand history. And that's why I'm looking for them.
Okay. It makes sense. I mean, is there any questions at this point? Is everybody with? Yes? Yeah, okay.
I'm trying to understand when you're recognizing different parts of the culture through what you're doing, are you saying that you yourself are different parts of the culture, and so those
No.
parts of you were coming out, or you're saying you have seen those things in culture, or?
I'm saying that what a variety of cultural groups do is or unique to their particular historic frame of reference and technologies that they have available to them, and value system and concept of art, if we're talking about art here.
So you use those techniques in terms of working with these objects, is that correct?
With what objects?
Do you consciously use another part of the culture's techniques in doing your art?
No, I don't. I acknowledge my own frame of reference in terms of my own work and honor it. I simply say that that frame of reference is relative to these things, which is culture and available technology and idea of what art is. And so I have my own. And if I do borrow from other people, I do it with the full knowledge that that I am borrowing from somebody else, but I acknowledge and respect my own frame of reference as well.
The question that he asked originally is sort of interesting in that he was saying, is it independent of you're looking at it? In other words, are you finding different aspects of yourself as you're going through this process? And to me, that's an interesting question, because if somebody else were doing exactly what you're doing, would they then come up with a whole different set of information?
Absolutely, and the way I structured it was ethnic community. Somebody else would structure it in a totally different way. And so, yeah, it can be cut in a million ways.
Yeah.
This is just the way I just happen to do it, but it's definitely a... But then there is this issue of are there more relevant ways to slice it? You know, what makes sense? And you'll get a different perspective. I could make 10 different exhibitions based on 10 different ways of slicing it.
Absolutely.
Does this get back to your original question? Is there truth in the art?
Yeah. Where were you going with that? With the is there truth in the art? That's an interesting thing to bring in.
No, it's Karen's question.
What was the question?
Yeah, Sharon's asking.
I was trying to figure out the extent of the overlap by pushing it in other directions so that people who are interested in feminist science studies mm-hmm. are still very interested in notions such as objectivity and truth, but defining them in different ways than the traditional notions, because we certainly don't want to say that fascist ways of doing science are just as good as feminist ways of doing science, for example. Mm-hmm. And we do want to still have better health care for people and so on. And all of those things have to be done in a particular situation. They have to be situated knowledges. That's what I would call, that's a term from Donna Haraway, actually. That's what I would call about the way that Sheila is describing the cultural specificity of a historical view.
Could you expand on feminist ways of doing science?
Yeah, it's a very complicated thing at this particular moment in time, but I think that, and it's also very varied. I mean, I would have to paint a whole array of different approaches and different philosophies about this right now.
I just like sample.
Well, I think that there are concerns everywhere about examining the ways in which science gets done, the questions that are asked, how questions in part determine the answers, the interpretation of work, the use of work. How are the fact that those things are in fact coupled, okay? So there's a concern about you know, what kind of work does a separation between the notion of pure science and applied science do in this particular society? Who does that benefit? Why is it in place?
I think, for instance, I was rereading one of your articles, and at one point you used the example of Richard Feynman and how Richard Feynman talked about it. It had a certain kind of a very playful, almost irresponsible way of going after scientific knowledge, and it sounded as though you were saying that was a well, I don't want to restate you, but it might be helpful to get to talk about it, a specific example that way.
There are concerns about the way in which physics has developed as a profession and as a subculture within the Western world. Which is the fact that there has been this emphasis ever since quantum mechanics, ironically enough, but certainly after World War II, it has become a viewpoint that what you just do is go ahead and calculate, and that meaning has been stripped away. Because people couldn't understand what quantum mechanics meant. Niels Bohr was very much interested in wrestling with that question, but many other physicists, and I think it's in fact fair to say that the majority of physicists, certainly in the US at that moment of time, were very much more interested in getting the numbers out. And so if any of you have taken physics courses, you were probably taught how to get the numbers out, and that's mostly the way we teach physics. And that means that there are very profound questions about the meaning of quantum mechanics and also about the discipline overall that haven't been approached in a long time, or not sufficiently. So that there's now a way in which people are saying that it's important to understand the meaning of what we're doing, the cultural situatedness of what we're doing, the fact that science is socially constructed, and in fact, the even more kind of profound and outrageous claim that nature itself is socially constructed, and to try to figure out what that could possibly mean. And in this context, still to try to have some notion of objectivity or of things being more true or less false or however you want to talk about that in terms of thinking about theories as guides to action, okay? Given a particular way of looking at things, is this the best way of looking at things? How can I move from here? What kinds of things would I do with the science that I have in hand? How would I develop it, and so on? And so these are the types of concerns that feminists are very much are really wrestling with in terms of science. People who are scientists themselves and people who are philosophers and historians of science who are trying to think about these questions, sociologists of science who are trying to think about these questions as well. So it's a very interdisciplinary endeavor of trying to realize the way in which knowledge and being is socially constructed, is the way that I would say it, but at the same time not wanting to throw the baby out with the bathwater. So in fact, just picking up on what Eugenia was asking me, I think that there's a way in which physicists have started to treat physics like a game. It's just a fun mind game, you know? And so Feynman talks about the fact that he was very pleased that von Neumann had helped him see during the Los Alamos project that he didn't have to be responsible for the world. And, you know, that was a point at which he just thought that numbers were a really great thing and figuring out a problem for the sake of figuring it out. And I think that that's something we have to move away from. So what I would like to see is a way in which we can respect social constructivism, but I want to in some ways get back to a notion of realism to balance off that notion of play that we have right now, which I think is particularly dangerous. So in all of that, it brings up for me questions of truth and objectivity, and I wanted to see in what ways, if any, Sheila's notion of thinking about what I would call an agential reality, whether those issues come into play for her project at all.
And it's a toughie. Because I think that for a person to be authentic in what they do, they must think that what they do is truth from their perspective. And so you can't do anything with any kind of veracity or integrity unless you think it's the way it is from the way it looks to you. And so it's a hard one to try to. I think in our Western paradigms of trying to argue things, it's as if it's either truth or not truth, but in some way it's truth, it's relativistic truth of some sort. But what Karen did ask me is, in this exhibition of this cross-cultural exhibition of photography, and in general, is the work of the people outside of the power structure, does that work have more truth in it or more integrity? Isn't that what you asked me?
Yeah.
Than the work of people who are within it. Mm-hmm. And it's complicated because if I'm trying to see a historic reality, and that's why I did this multicultural focus show, to actually just see what is, then what is a historic truth, which is that the work that was done by the white upper middle class educated artists in the show was all in color materials and a kind of abstraction. And the work by all the other groups had to do with very focused cultural content and reflecting their own struggles and perspective at that historic moment. And so what the show reflected was the kind of work that comes out of a social position. Now the question is, then can you create a value? Can you evaluate that work, right? And yes, you certainly can. You can say what has more meaning to you, what do you care, what affects you more, and that's certainly possible to do. One is just looking at what happens in history, and another is trying to see to evaluate it. And I think that you can. I was stumbling around with Karen mainly because it's so complicated. Because there's several levels in the world of art making or any creative activity.
Or music making.
And I think maybe we should turn this maybe over to you, or would you?
I'm happy.
But the way I was constructing it as we were coming over was that there's the levels of doing it, and in my experience of teaching people to do it, they start with wherever they start. You start with your home base in terms of making things, and what's your priorities and what you're able to do. And if in that, and often you have to do, you have to find your center or your garden of some sort. And that might be, in a lot of cases, an idealized image or place or thing that you're creating. And often, once a person has found that, they then go ahead and do work that is more related to the external world and is more about issues of consciousness in culture, cultural consciousness. But in my experience, I don't know that I can teach somebody to get into the cultural domain without having first had this other strengthening interior experience of making the ideal. And so in terms of cultural consciousness, the ideal might not be part of that issue. But in terms of the development of the individual, it's a crucial step. And so when I think about the politics of art making, I think the very first is where the evolution of the interior of the person. And if it's an evolutionary process for the person, that's crucial. And then the second step is to what extent then does it let them know about the external world? And then the third step is to what extent does it affect other people looking at it? And so when the work not only is viable for the individual, but it has another layer, which is that when other people look at it, they are affected by it, and in some way, in their consciousness is affected by it. Then, for me, that's the most resolved
work. I wonder if that's like the moon and the positioning in any way. I mean, there's a very strong relationship at that point between the observer and the thing that is produced. I mean, maybe that's really stretching it.
Well, in the full analogy, though, we would need something like about how the observer was actually changing the agential reality of the thing.
Don't you think that's always true, that the observer interprets the art?
Sure.
And what you thought, what you might say, oh, this is realistic,
mm-hmm.
and this is abstract.
Right.
Someone else who all they saw were pastels, and that's how they dreamt and everything, they might say, that's my reality. And I guess that's what was bothering me about the whole thing. Like, I'm not sure we all evolved the same way, right? Through,
right.
And I don't think you meant to say that the Latinos were more evolved in their artwork than the upper middle class, you're still in the
no.
in the abstract. You didn't mean to say that, but that's sort of as you pull your students through this process. You know, maybe the viewer does, I think, always change the reality of at least what they see. Right?
Yeah.
And all of those things coexist in the culture at the same time. I mean, we are living in a time where abstraction is culturally very important in terms of our modalities of thinking. I mean, this century is a century, I think, it's a century where there's been a tremendous, it seems to be, leaps. I mean, it seems like you deal in a very abstract universe at the same time you deal in a very real universe. And yet there's all of these crises, of these cultural crises within this century as well. So it makes sense that there would be all of these refractions.
But I want to say something, because yes, the viewer is always interpreting the thing viewed, and that's true. But what my students would like me to allow them is to do something that is so broad that, well, people can think anything they want about it. Right? They
right.
would love for me to do this.
That's sort of the lack of responsibility.
Right. And so I won't let them. I say that a poet is somebody who's not just selecting random words and you hopefully will think a thought. A poet is somebody who is very precisely selecting every word. and is very precise about the meaning of those nuances. And you have an extremely precise thing when you're done, and the thing that you have when you're done is something that has a broad base of meaning for a variety of people who do come to it with their own history. But it's not just some bag of words.
But how do you compare that with what you did with the objects, in which you approach those objects in many, many different ways, but you approach them intuitively without that thought, without that concentration on each word?
I did have a concentration on each word.
You did?
Yes. And the way I did it was that I used each of the technologies to manifest this cube. And when I looked at the inherent language that was suggested to my mind, because I'm doing it in this particular instance, in terms of the meaning of the technology and its way of interpreting the cube, I came up with a formal construct for the most appropriate form for that technology.
But you know what's really interesting is that I remember you a couple of moments ago talking about how each person has their own reality, mm-hmm. and that's where it comes out of, that's their own truth. And so there's this disjunct, in a sense, between the whole idea of I am an artist and I make this work out of this experiential matrix, in a sense, which is myself, what you're describing as this process, and yet, in a sense, you're saying to your students that you say that you can't, that's not available to them.
I didn't say that to my students.
No.
Okay. I let them do it, and I just keep showing them all kinds of stuff.
Okay.
But what you don't understand is that I do think that is not a free-floating mind.
Mm-hmm.
I am a product of my
sure.
acculturation.
Sure, and of a long time of working as well.
But also, I am a product of my historical, mm-hmm. my socioeconomic group, my education.
Mm-hmm.
I am not
mm-hmm.
a free-floating. I don't think these things up just by accident.
Mm-hmm.
I am part of my of this time and
mm-hmm.
this, and so I understand that.
Mm-hmm.
I don't. Yeah,
I mean, I think one of the things that's fascinating about the process that you were describing, which sounded incredibly strenuous, you know, is that I mean, it does situate you. It does. It's like taking this, trying to look at all of the constructs that you do, that you are in at this time, and identifying them all. I mean, it's a very interesting, very strenuous, very, very. Laborious kind of examination, which is
well. So it, when I was doing it,
uh-huh.
it didn't seem so laborious.
Yeah,
it didn't sound like it.
Yeah.
But what happens is you're just doing intuitively,
mm-hmm.
but then you step back and you see, is there something that's happened here that makes some sense
mm-hmm.
on a larger
mm-hmm.
level?
So you're talking about process in a way. Is the process is your process completely different from that? Is your process further? I mean, when you do your work.
What is it like? What is it like on the inside? That's weird. Ask me an easy question.
Can you imagine what you do?
Well, I can tell you that a mathematician.
Okay.
Because I'm a mathematician and also a musician.
Mm-hmm.
And a mathematician does kind of exactly what Sheila's doing when you, it struck me that that's exactly what we do. Now you make up, except that you don't find something at a Chinese restaurant or Japanese restaurant.
It's wipe it.
You, yeah, it's wipe it. You just invent it. You invent a structure
mm-hmm.
of some sort. And it might come from what you thought, reality was, or what some physicists told you they thought it was.
Can you give us an example?
Well, I do a lot of, I do dynamical systems,
mm-hmm.
that's one of my areas, and in dynamical systems we invent what we call models. The model is just a formula that's supposed to describe something that's evolving through time.
Mm-hmm.
And so you have a, and when I say something, I mean it could be a population or a economic structure or the way the fashion industry works or something
could
like
it,
that.
Could it be an object as well? It would be a field of objects.
It could be a crystal or growing or,
Okay.
Right now I'm working on cancer tumors.
Mm-hmm.
Oh, they grow. Okay, so cancer tumors, for example. So you have some structure that lives in some space and you have some laws that govern its evolution and then you, but those laws are just formulas and they're abstract now. They're not real anymore. And then...
Do you invent the formulas?
Yeah, the mathematician would invent. And you, you know, you might have some reason originally for doing this, but in the end you just have this structure that lives nowhere but in your head. And then you let it evolve. You look at it in all sorts of different ways and in all, with all sorts of different technology. And our technology might be, our tools are different. Sometimes we put them on the computer, like I'm sure architects do, these CAD things and stuff, and watch pictures of them, but sometimes you hit them with other tools like topology. You study just how many holes they have in them. That's all. Forget about everything else. Or geometry. You study, angles and points and those kinds of things. Or sometimes you study them probabilistically. What's it like most of the time if I look at most of it? Which is a totally different way of looking at these things. And eventually, like you did when you made your exhibit, you take the ones, it's not just random stuff. You look at the things that make sense, and usually they make sense. Why? Because they make some connection to something. And that's, I think, the cultural situation, but the culture now is the whole history of mathematics and everything else you know. Or maybe if you're trying to describe something real, then you go to the doctors and you say, does this look like a real tumor to you now?
Mm-hmm.
So you
take your imaginary tumor and you hold it up to reality.
You have zillions of them now.
Uh-huh.
You have tumors that never could really exist.
Do you ever invent something which is totally theoretical, which is totally abstract, which doesn't have a and what happens to that? Does that move into reality at some point? Does that stay?
Never. Probably never.
What about the... What?
Many things, like things in, infinitely many dimensions the mathematicians have invented so many worlds and universes and words to go along with them that, that's part of the fun and part of the isolation of it.
Mm-hmm. But it does ultimately have some impact, or does it have ultimately have some
Not
impact
always.
On reality?
Not always. And I think there's a move, though, now, at least economically, meaning what research gets funded. Now there's a push to fund research that does have application, and I think that it's having a pretty heavy impact on the kind of mathematics you're going to see.
Well, you were talking about that the other night when you said that there's this part of it is that it's all happening through computers, right? Is that, am I remembering you correctly?
The computers had a big effect on certain areas of mathematics because now we can see things that we couldn't see before. We can look at them in new ways that we couldn't before. But in a way, it makes things look more real than they are.
Mm-hmm.
And that's, I think, a danger.
Are there corollaries between Karen's idea of feminist physics and mathematics, or is it what where do you where does that does it I mean does that is that
you know,
a, even a non is that a sensible
I think,
question?
I think there are, but I'm afraid to say I don't. It's not something I've kept up with. I know that. There have been a lot of studies about how men and women think about mathematics differently, and why there are there so many more men than women, or why brains are different sizes. And you know, why are the girls better until sixth grade and then they're not anymore? And there's been a lot of work on that. What is it, especially about the discourse that takes place within mathematics? How do mathematicians, and you might have this image of them, especially after the Unabomber and stuff, you know, they're these people that go and isolate themselves in their rooms and just work all the time and don't talk to anyone. And one theory is that women don't like to do that, and so now there's a group learning thing. And
well, and actually you do that with your music as well, because you take the dynamical chaos that you're studying theoretically and you move it into music, right? Mm-hmm. And so in a sense, you're, as a human being, you're doing that. You're moving that abstract, the nature of that abstract into a field of reality. I was very struck today. I got on your website.
Yeah.
And one of the things, I want to know what that picture was. There's the website address is ezrab.pomona.edu, right?
Right.
And on that website is that a fractal? What is that picture?
The one.
The picture that's like it's like these two spirals.
Right, that's a fractal.
That's a fractal. Uh-huh. Yeah. How did that picture develop? What does it come from?
It's an example of what I was talking about. We take a function and repeat it over and over. You put in a number, get out a number, put that number back in, and you see what happens to those numbers. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. And it's a picture of the complex plane, meaning you're using complex numbers which live in two dimensions. So you get this two-dimensional picture where you color each number by where it went after you fed it through this function box over and over. If it went zooming off to infinity, you color it black, and if it went not so fast, or the opposite, either way. Anyway, you color it by how big it got, and you get those beautiful pictures.
And so you're making a picture of what happened with that number in a way. Is that true? Is that because I was really fascinated. I wish we could call it up, because I was really fascinated with its beauty and also its relationship to Sheila, for instance, some of the things that you've done that you know, you joke and you say, well, they're so beautiful you don't tell anybody that you're doing them. I made connections with my own work, you know, where there's this idea of looking into the field, which is this field of the idea, and almost pulling. I mean, I try to do it out through vision or through my body, but I was struck with the similarity of the kinds of things that, for instance, you were coming up with and I was coming up with, or that you were coming up with. And it to go back to what you were talking about when you first sat down, and you were talking about this whole idea of realities. Mm-hmm. And it's very hard for me to voice it. It's very hard to put a words to this idea, but it's one of the things that fascinated me about bringing all of us together. Is that there's this fascination with dealing in the field of reality, and I'm so hard. It's so hard for me to be able to to put words to it. I'm going back to some of the questions that you were asking, and can I call them up again? I mean, does that. That when you were, because you were making relationships in terms of reality and what Sheila is doing and what Karen is doing.
So, I think that, you know how these fractals and chaos theorems have caught the attention of all of, I bet lots of you here have heard of those words, right?
Mm-hmm.
And,
sure.
And, you know, I've often wondered why that is. Why are some mathematical objects so, they catch on, or... Mm-hmm. Things in physics too, like the singularities and black holes, and there's certain things. And I wonder if it's because they're more real, or uh-huh. or they must resonate with something.
Or they
something.
Have a story, maybe. Maybe
or
there's
because,
a.
Yeah.
I don't know. I mean, there's something that you can attach to them that is some kind of a narrative, maybe, or some kind of and.
Well, what I like about these mathematical objects that I look at, the ones that I make music and pictures and stuff out of, are it's because they do seem alive somehow. Ooh. So what does that mean, alive? Well, some kind of unpredictability combined with familiarity or connections with what went before. And my guess is that's why people like them.
They're alive. Talk about that a little bit more.
They grow, they have babies, they that look like themselves, but a little different, and they mutate. And
and these are the numbers themselves.
The numbers, and not just each individual numbers, but the patterns that the numbers make.
And so does that move from an imaginary thing to a real thing? And does, I mean, what is it?
No, it's all imaginary, but it can
why
say something a bit, because I can't say the word real anymore.
Why not? Tell me why not.
Because I learned in the car. You can't say real.
Why can't you say real?
I'm teasing here. But no, I think she's right. I mean, real?
Why can't we say real?
It's very point-based. Particularly without quotes around it. I think too many people put quotes around the word real now, and I hate that.
Real.
I think there are real bodies and there's real material existence, and I think that they need to be paid attention to. They need to be attended to and in responsible ways. And so as much as I think that social constructivism and post-structuralism and other things have brought us very many important insights, there's a way in which only materiality is only half dealt with oftentimes.
What do you mean materiality is only half dealt with? What's the half we're dealing with, what's the half we're not dealing with?
I think that at least the stuff that I'm reading deals with kind of the material consequences of discourse, which I think is incredibly important.
The material consequences of discourse. My brain is leaking on needles. I'm trying to the material consequences of discourse.
Well, I'm thinking about the work of Judith Butler, for example, who talks about the discursive limits of sex and how sex becomes materialized out of certain constitutive constraints. That discourses have a way of manifesting themselves materially. So she talks about the social construction, not only of gender but of sex itself.
Okay, I want to make this more real. Okay, she's talking about sex.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, and she's talking about now. I'm having a hard time with the language because it feels like a distance language to me. So I'm trying to get a picture in my mind.
Well, it has to do with the way in which Michel Foucault and other theorists have talked about how the body is disciplined.
Mm-hmm. The body
is made to have certain forms and conform certain ways according to certain institutions.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. So we have an imagined idea of what our body is. That in a sense is derived from the constructs that we've learned from the institution.
Yeah, I mean,
is that what you're saying?
There's an example in Susan Bordeaux's work. She's talking about how in Avion ads, they're telling you on the one hand that you should be anybody you want to be, literally anybody.
Mm-hmm.
But at the same time, they're giving you an image of what your body should look like.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Uh-huh. So there's a way in which our culture gives messages to people. You know, lots of teenagers become anorexic and so on and so forth. I mean, there are ways in which the body is definitely disciplined by different kinds of discourse within the culture. And so people are very concerned about trying to understand ways in which discourse actually molds the material existence.
Okay.
because lots of billion-dollar industry, dieting is a billion-dollar mm-hmm. industry.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Right. So there are ways, and also people now are treating bodies like plastic, so on, okay? People literally try to, you know, materially reform their bodies to either take on a different sexual image, a different gender, a different race,
mm-hmm.
A different culture. There are all sorts of ways in which, either through actual surgery or dieting or wearing certain clothing, that we take on bodies that have seemingly become more plastic.
Mm-hmm. So is this again this line between reality and non-reality. I mean, it's it seems to me that on a certain level we have it seems to me that one of the fascinations in pop culture is this line between fiction and fantasy, the idea of yourself. And it's really interesting to talk to a physicist about these lines, because I have this sense in a way that you're, on some level in your work, you're dealing with the you call them the cuts.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, you're almost trying to set up a physical engine to look very specifically at what it is that we do, or what it is that we are doing. And so does an artist. I mean, construct reality, understand, I think, through vision, through seeing, through the systems that you develop to mold this. I don't want to call it a plane, I don't know what to call it. I mean, the language is very difficult. But there's these imaginary objects. There's these that also enter in. I mean, that they enter into our field of what is real. Not all of the time, but in a sense they do. I mean, we can look at a tape, and we can look at music.
I mean, there are ways in which fractals are real.
Mm-hmm.
How are fractals real? As physicists are
mm-hmm.
concerned.
Tell me about that. What are the interrelationships between your field and your field? Or where do fractals become real?
In that we think that many naturally occurring phenomena
mm-hmm.
are actually fractals. So the shoreline, for example,
mm-hmm.
is thought to be a fractal.
Mm-hmm.
What is a fractal? It's a self-similar object.
Mm-hmm.
No matter what scale you look at it on, it looks the same.
Mm-hmm.
So clouds. So for example, in order to try to make the landscape look real,
mm-hmm.
in some science fiction movies, I forget which ones, they used fractals generated on these very fast computers in order to try to make it jaggedy enough
mm-hmm.
looking so that it looks real to the human eye.
Mm-hmm.
They have an organic feel,
mm-hmm.
which is, well, I guess, why Melanie said they're alive.
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. And that's true. And I mean, they're more real than a straight line, a perfectly straight line in some sense.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah,
of course they are. Because very few places in the physical construct that we actually have straight lines.
But if a fractal must be infinitely, on every scale, like Karen said, it's got to look the same, or at least, you know, as complex as it was on the scale above. And if we believe that matter at some level is quantized, then that
matter is
a fractal. There you go. It's not quantized, meaning there's a certain scale on which you can break it up no more.
Uh-huh.
There it is. That's it. A solid quark. If we magnify that, it doesn't look the same as this whole big complicated thing did.
Uh-huh.
And so if that's true, then
things are only approximately
things
fractals.
Are only a fractal on a sort of macroscopic level. But that's, you know, that's good enough, I mean, to look through. Just like Newton's equations are pretty good for telling us where the ball will land.
Right.
Even though that's, you know, the ball's not really there. You're not there, but it's good enough. We want to, you know.
The moon's not there. No, the moon's not there.
So, fractals are maybe more real.
Mm-hmm. Do you think that's why they're possibly people are more interested in them because they have their closest?
I think so. I mean, I ask you guys that.
Yeah. I mean, what's
I'm interested in because I make my living that way. But just kidding.
But couldn't they be real if they just remain ideas?
Real ideas.
When you're looking at fractals, are you reducing it or are you expanding it?
Either one. Yeah. Because you could expand it by, you know, you start with a little seed. This is what musicians often do. Or those imaginary landscapes that you're talking about. They start with a seed and let it grow. So then you're watching it. You're zooming out. Maybe.
But then,
so either way.
Then when Sheila, when you talk about ideas being real, I'm interested because I know that you in a certain way, you know, you work in this very cultural context. I mean that you and I fight all the time because you know, I mean you see these real political stakes, which I really admire. But it's interesting. It's interesting to hear you say that. I mean, that, you know. I mean, of course, I know that you know that you know you think that ideas are real. But I'm always trying to understand what. I don't know. How does that operate for you? I mean, how does that the difference between the idea of a thing and then this real definite import in the cultural context? Am I asking you too abstract a question or?
I don't know.
Come on.
No, I don't know. I don't know what the answer to your question is.
Okay, I guess maybe let me see if I can restate it. I think that one of the things that interests me about this grouping is this whole jump between the imaginary, the idea of a thing, and this and the reality of the thing. And I mean, in a sense, that Karen to me, in a way, deals with the ideas of things very, very, very specifically, but you also deal with the matter of things very, very specifically. And you deal with it your ideas are very, very strong, but yet they're manifest and really pragmatically in the world.
I mean, I think I can understand.
Okay.
And it's this is a great dialogue because, you know, in the process, I am understanding my own process a lot better because I never abstracted like this.
Mm-hmm.
but like now I do all this cultural work rather than all that.
Why don't you talk, like, for instance, about the Cambodian piece or something? Because I want to pull people in to really understand. I don't want this to get so heady that we all get out of our bodies and we get lost.
But I was doing these things called thermonuclear gardens for about 8 years that were information artwork about the growth of the military and the extent to which we arm foreign countries. And these were exhibitions that I had in museums and galleries around the country.
Should I
just
speak up a little?
Sure. And should I say that? Okay. And so, and then I discovered that there were refugee camps in Thailand, and I had no idea that they existed. And so after doing all this work, I discovered that they were there. So I went and photographed Cambodian and Hmong refugees in these camps. And then ultimately, this led to going to Phnom Penh and photographing in Cambodia. And then that led to going into the Cambodian community in Los Angeles and photographing. I did some exhibitions called Remember Cambodia that were a synthesis of all of this experience. And basically, the way I am approaching this is similar to the way I approached my cue, in the sense that I get into something and I actually say, I don't have a clue as to what the reality is. I can only know, I just have to get in there and start to experience something. And let the heterogeneous experience of all aspects of it come into my experience somehow. And then little by little, I actually start to understand something better. And it's this process of being chaotic for a while, mm-hmm. actually, and I like the chaos. Mm-hmm. It's in the sense that it's you can't make any. It's the edge of your ability to organize.
Mm-hmm.
And so if you're willing to go through this very uncomfortable time of not knowing what you're doing, which is makes it sound like you're kind of bumbling through, which is
but that seems to be a really important part of
yeah,
it.
Yeah, it's a crucial part because it's only then that you can find these new constructs. And I'll give you an example. I'm trying to do this exhibition. It's feeling like I'm slogging through. I can't get it done. Nothing's working. My computer stopped talking to my printer. And I mean, it's just like if it could go wrong, it has go wrong, right? But in the middle there, trying to get this show done, I've been doing this. I've been photographing work protests in the garment industry in Los Angeles. And over the net, I got this research paper on the state of the garment workers in Phnom Penh, and that they're protesting. And then I began to understand that the working conditions and the wage structure and so on for people in the garment industry in Phnom Penh and in Los Angeles are almost identical. Not the same numbers, but the same problems. And so it didn't ever occur to me that in a country like Cambodia and in a place like Los Angeles, you would have the same worker problems. Identical worker problems. And we normally have this colonial idea of first world, third world, or pre-technological and technological, however you construct it, but when you actually look at what's going on, they're identical. So it broke down my assumptions about this way we structure our geopolitical relationship. And then I began to realize that the shape of LA County and the shape of Cambodia were almost identical. And then I began to realize that Cambodia has 8 million and Los Angeles is 8 million, and that I could make this thing that goes like this to snap it in the shape and say, it's not like this and this, it's like this and this.
That's fascinating.
And that's what I mean when I say that I'm just collecting stuff, but at a certain point,
something
happens.
Something snaps in, yeah.
Right. And you never know what it is. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. And so you just take the trip of it, and if you could stand not knowing what you're doing for a long enough time, then it snaps in the shape, and then that gets to be exciting.
Mm-hmm.
Well, it seems to me that what you're talking about on an individual level is exactly what we're doing as groups. So the kind of questions that you're asking about what reality is and what isn't reality is the same sort of a place. If we're interested in it, there must be some connection to something real.
Mm-hmm.
We just don't know what it is.
Go with that a little bit further.
Well, you know, it's just to me a parallel. She's describing her own work and what we're doing as people as we're going through this process of dealing with new things and this questioning this relationship between reality and non-reality. It's very similar.
It is. I mean, when I was driving over here this afternoon, there was a way when I was thinking, well, this is. You know, I mean, this is, we are constructing reality in a place, in a certain way as we go through this discussion. We are undergoing a certain kind of creative field or an activity, you know, an interconnected something. And I was trying to understand how to understand that, how to make a picture of that, how to connect that in some way. And in a funny way, you just did that.
Well, in another way, though, it is really a non-question. What the reality is, is a non-question.
How is it a non-question?
Well, I mean, if we think about it, you know, it's real on some level. If we can, you know, find some thoughts around this thing, you know, in a way, it becomes real. So then,
in what way,
you know, whether it has a material.
Good.
In what way does it become real?
In your own mind's eye, it has sensory relevance, it has weight, it's real in your eye. Your perception of physics is, I don't know your relationship or your relation with the world, but it's quite different, your viewpoint on physics and reality.
It's quite different what? I'm sorry, I didn't pick up the word.
It's quite different from Bohr's on reality or physics.
Bohr's view?
Yes.
No, it's pretty
similar. Pretty close.
Yeah.
I think at some level there are some differences.
Oh, I'm sure.
sure there are.
And I think that's what I'm going to point out. I mean, there are certain rules of business that both understand and recognize. And at that level, I think you can say that about these questions. We all have the answers to them. For some, if the questions remain questions, in a way, that's also an answer. Yeah. It's like having free will and just or freedom to act and deciding not to act. I mean, that's your freedom. You've already acted.
Actually, it doesn't question very much in a way. What it questions is a very, it's interesting. I think Amy's question about why people are so fascinated with fractals, I think is a really important question. And I don't think we've gotten to the heart of it yet.
Well, let's go.
I think that, first of all, that a lot of people don't realize the connection between fractals and chaos and what that is. I think there's a certain level of aesthetic appreciation for fractals that is actually seen separately from anything having to do with chaos theory.
Is that all terrible?
Sorry?
Is that all terrible?
No, I didn't have any value judgment at all. I'm
just asking.
Okay. No, I don't think it's terrible. Okay. I'm just trying to lay out a map here of the way that I'm viewing this. And again, there's no value judgment about what I just said. I just think that certain people view those things separately, that's all. Not a problem. I think that there are ways in which there's also kind of a fascination with chaos theory that I just want to say as a way of talking about those things separately. Is a different kind of fascination than the fascination with fractals. Even though for physicists and mathematicians, they are connected at some very deep level. I think the fascination of chaos theory has to do with something different than aesthetics. And I think it has to do with a more sense of the place where we find ourselves, our human condition now, or whatever. I think there's a more political sense in which chaos has an appeal, and I think fractals are seen in a more aesthetic sense.
What do you think is the political attraction of chaos?
Questions about, in our postmodern era, whatever that means, about order, about rationality, about, you know.
The sheer feeling of living in a world that is, in a sense, completely out of control. I mean, is that?
Yeah, I think that there's questions about whether the stories we've been telling ourselves are really, you know, whether that order exists or whether the order has been imposed.
Mm-hmm.
And I think what chaos does is allow a certain kind of imagination to go free about ways in which to see that there's possibly even order within
mm-hmm.
chaos. I mean, that's one of the fascinations
mm-hmm.
of chaos.
Sure,
is that it's not total randomness, right?
Mm-hmm.
but it's interesting to me, particularly, what's your name?
Karen.
Hi. I like what you were saying about breaking out of certain frameworks, but I'm fascinated by it because in some ways, for a physicist, at least, and probably for mathematicians, it isn't such a profound thing, chaos theory. The way in which it's taken on a kind of profundity within the culture at large,
much more profound undoing of a worldview than chaos theory ever could approach. Because it questions not only the way we know, but also what exists. Mm-hmm. And that's not, what chaos theory is doing is it's loosening a kind of Newtonian determinism. That,
Loosening.
Yeah, it's kind of loosening the determinism that Newton gave us and Laplace popularized as saying, you know, like I have.
That's the extent of my science.
Yeah.
And I've done that, and it was almost equivalent to the word of God, right? Mm-hmm. I mean, the way it goes back to your earlier statement mm-hmm. about how you're taught these things in school.
That's right.
So this is right, this is right, this is right.
Right.
And there's nothing else outside mm-hmm. of the scope of mm-hmm. thought.
Yeah.
Until you take physics theory.
Don't you think that if people had called chaos theory by another name, it wouldn't have been half as glamorous?
Yes, absolutely. Absolutely. I guess that's what I'm getting at.
Yeah. Because you know, chaos is something on a human level that we all experience in our own lives, etc. But quantum, do we experience quantum?
We do.
I'm very interested about the feminist quantum, though. Do you see quarks as girls? I'm just kidding. But the
I'm glad you aren't serious, because people have been serious in asking me that question. I was already geared up to do my defensive bit.
I don't know. I just have a sense, and I have absolutely, you know, no disciplined knowledge of what you people are into. But I have a sense that if there is a reality, we don't have a clue. We talk about it, we take little slices of it with our apparatus, such as it is, and we get some information which we then translate into behavior. And to me, you know, that's all we can do as individuals, even if our knowledge is great, such as yours and yours. There is still that little slice, that little window that opens into a much, much larger so-called reality, since I don't know what else to call it, of which most is totally veiled in ways that I don't think human beings will ever be able to fathom, because we just don't have, even though we're aided by our technology, and our technology has allowed us to do chaos equations, etc. Did you see Arcadian?
No.
You should have. Okay. But anyway, all of those things to me are very they make us make mistakes in thinking, because the truth that you were talking about before is, to me, something that encompasses areas that for generations and for centuries and for millennia we have little by little eradicated from our consciousness, which is the realities of other living forms on this planet. We feel and we act as if we are the only life form on this planet. And I think that the glamour of fractals is that they are so fern-like and so, you know, plant-like, and oh gosh, you know, there are plants here. Great, you know, and here they are translated into scientific images. As we speak, in Antarctica, the animals in the ocean are being decimated by that ozone hole, you know, and that's to me a reality which is much more tangible and much, much more affective than anything that I can experience here. I've been, by the way, completely distracted by these little fires. Talk about chaos, you know, which ones are going to burn until the end of the dialogue, which ones are going to die off, no way of telling, right? So the point that I'm trying to make is that I'm more, as I get older and life as it really is on the planet, and as if it just doesn't exist. And little by little, because we are the observers and we are creating this reality, it will cease to exist. At that point, we will cease to exist, you know. So to me, all this truth stuff is constructs that unless we begin to see the big picture and to take it into our bodies, into our consciousness, we're going to be up Schitt's Creek. And that's a reality which to me is very meaningful because I would like to live a long time.
Right. One of the things that I say to my students is if we keep talking about the world independently of us human beings as the world that we want to know, then that's what we're going to have. So I want the focus to be on the fact that we don't live on a dirt ball that's dead, and that there's a way in which we are always within nature, so we have to see ourselves as knowers, as being, as the knowledge coming from the between, as Eugenia was saying from my paper, with the fact that we are, as Niels Bohr would always say, we are a little part of nature. We don't stand outside of from nature, viewing nature, and that there's a kind of separation there that I think is particularly dangerous and irresponsible. So I would really agree with your remarks.
And I do too. And I think that it's my sense or my belief or my feeling or my, you know, all these kinds of things that these very abstract disciplines actually bring a tremendous weight to bear on how we really organize and perceive our sense of being in the world, our epistemology. So that even though it is very abstract and far away in a certain way, it's about change. It's really, to me, it seems to be about change. Because if we stop looking for the theory of everything, for instance, well, and pay more attention to the world that is, in the discipline of physics, then tremendous forces come to bear differently in a short-term moment. I mean, is it the same as picking this up? No, it may not be, but I'm not so sure. I mean, I just want to throw that into the.
Well, I personally look at theories as guides to action, so it's very much consistent with what you're saying. And if my theory, I mean, I was actually doing research on quarks for quite a long time. That was what my PhD thesis was on. I stopped doing that because at first, you see, I was very comforted by the fact that because of the way in which quarks behave, there nobody could ever build such a thing as a quark bomb. In fact, there was no way, in other words, there was no way in which quarks are the things that make up protons and neutrons, and there seems to be no way in which quarks will ever be a useful thing, and that is that people can manipulate in ways to like get lots of energy out of them or other things that people found in playing with the atom. And I found great comfort in that at first, and then I became quite depressed about the fact that there was zero use. You see, first it was comforting.
Interesting.
And yeah. Then it became, well, and then it started to feel like a big game. And as much as it was, fun for my mind, it started to feel like that was the only thing that it was of use for. And as I became more and more politicized, it became less and less important to me. And so what has become important to me is real beings, real material existence, the fact that there are real lives at stake.
And so what are if you will, what are some of the emotional aspects or the political aspects of choosing to work on quantum theory?
Because it's a shift in worldview that I think could be extremely important.
We'll talk about that a little, will you? Can you? Will you please?
Because what it does is it undermines the Newtonian worldview, both in terms of its determinism, because it gives us a very different notion of causality, but also in terms of its objectivism.
How does it give us a very different notion of causality?
Well, according to Newtonian physics, the way Laplace popularized it is if I have the initial position and the initial velocity of every particle, then I know its entire future trajectory and its entire path. So in other words, according to Newtonian physics, I had no choice but to be here tonight.
Mm-hmm.
True. Really nice. None of us had any choice but to
be here. No, it doesn't work that way.
None of us had any choice. Mm-hmm. There's no room for free will mm-hmm. in that particular worldview. And furthermore, there's this sense of objectivism in that the world just evolves and things are just the way they are, and the way that what physicists are supposed to be doing, according to Newton, is understanding the motion of the atoms in the void. And that's a very particular picture mm-hmm. that I now find very disturbing.
Mm-hmm.
But it's a picture that's already been undermined by quantum mechanics, at least in Niels Bohr's view, mm-hmm. and I should say that there are many different interpretations of quantum physics, and it's still up for grabs because people just started focusing on getting the numbers out and not wrestling with the meaning of them.
Mm-hmm.
But I find Niels Bohr's view particularly moving because, first of all, I see ways in which it is very parallel to conversations now about social constructivism, but he never lets go of bodies
mm-hmm.
in the process of talking about them.
Mm-hmm.
So I saw that there was a way to hold on to materiality and talk about social constructivism that I thought could bring people's feet to the ground who were having conversations like that. So what it does is it changes the place of the knower, and in my particular way of reading it, it makes the knower not somebody who gets to stand back and form knowledge, but an active participant in an ongoing ontology which changes and doesn't stand outside of ourselves.
Mm-hmm. So we stop seeing ourselves. We stop seeing ourselves outside of the world, essentially.
Yeah.
Which is exactly what Rachel was talking
right.
about. So how does that? So what is the? I mean, maybe this is a really far-fetched question. But I mean, what is the what is the line? Or is there, it wouldn't be a line, maybe it would be a fractal, between our understanding, our intellectual, theoretical understanding, and how that moves into the world, how that notion of causality really moves into the world, moves into an active public space, if you would.
Mm-hmm. Well, I think we act on our worldview.
Mm-hmm.
I don't think there are questions out there waiting to be answered.
Mm-hmm.
I think we create questions
mm-hmm.
out of our experiences and what our priorities and what's important to us.
Mm-hmm.
And so I think that we wind up asking different questions if we have a different worldview, and I think we need to be asking ourselves different kinds
mm-hmm.
of questions right now. If we ask ourselves questions all the time about what the world looks like independently of us
mm-hmm.
human beings, that's what we're going to get.
Mm-hmm. Do you agree? What do you think?
Yeah, I agree. I mean, I don't.
Did I spring that on you too fast?
Yeah, I was thinking about...
What were you thinking about?
What questions we ask. Mm-hmm. And I
what
think that for sure that's true, that the questions come up as, you know, you create them as you go, that's for sure. This business of determinism, if you know exactly where every particle is and its velocity, then you'll know the trajectory. If you add to that we can never know where we are and the velocity, right? Then you get complete, pretty complete complete unpredictability pretty quickly. So I was trying to think,
well, you get individual unpredictability.
Well, even unpredictability of the system, if you, I mean, of all of the system that you can observe in your lifetime, which is still a finite amount. It's just still a finite amount, but I mean, I know, you know, of course, if you know the, you knew the laws totally, you could know all the orbits that could exist, but you wouldn't know which one you're on, right?
Well, there aren't any orbits according to quantum physics. There aren't
right,
any trajectories.
So now I'm trying to, in my head, you know, see the how you would, what are those other questions then you would ask or ask me? So that's what I was thinking.
Mm-hmm, nice.
But, I didn't have an answer.
Yeah, where would you start going with that? Where would you start?
Yeah, go down to Karen's office. Uh-huh. Stuff to read.
That's exciting, actually, though. I mean, if those kind of questions came up out of this discussion, that's really fascinating.
But if we're interested in observable, what we can observe and what we can do in our lifetime to help the ozone layer, whatever, then maybe it's more important to construct models that will give us those kinds of answers quicker than to spend, all our time thinking about what's real.
Speaking about what's real.
Thinking about what's real has everything to do with the questions that we'll ask. So I don't think that's kind of this abstract conversation that takes place aside from things. So for example, just to give an example of different kinds of questions that get asked as a result of feminist science studies, the original research done on breast cancer was done on men. I mean, men do have 2% of the breast cancers, but the rationale for doing breast cancer research on men that was originally given was that menstrual cycles would ruin the data. Now, you know, so it depends what kind of data you're looking for. The model that you're setting up, given that that would be seen as a disruption of the methodology rather than something that has to be written into the methodology.
Which is, in a sense, Sheila's method. Just taking in, all taking in, putting as much of the construct in, and yours as well.
How long ago was this research?
More than 25 years ago now. I don't remember the exact dating of it.
Why did you ask that?
Well, earlier, just the conversation before, we're talking about advances in daylight time. Two lifetimes, and that started me thinking about how long it'll take us to go from Newtonian science to quantum physics. 200 years, essentially. And it took 25 years for people to realize, well, maybe we should start doing breast cancer research on people with breasts. I granted 25 years is a lot shorter than 200 years, but it's.
And was
that's
it
really glad I asked.
In your piece that I read today that there was also then George Bernard Shaw said something about that. He said it took us 200 years and then 500 years and now we're dealing with Einsteinian physics and it's all changing and
I mean imagine when
it's I mean the speed is what the speed of how we can affect reality perhaps is speeding up as well because we have so many more bodies on the planet.
Well, that's what Whitehead said in 1925.
Really?
Right.
Yeah.
I mean, imagine Whitehead's.
He said that it's the rate of progress which is increasing. And that's what's so hard.
Why is that so hard?
Well, for Whitehead, I think it was the fact of the matter that, we don't have, our worldview doesn't have enough time to catch up with the progress because the rate of progress keeps increasing. And so Whitehead, I mean, I think there are lots of similarities actually between Bohr and Whitehead. because I think that, I mean, Whitehead talks about a process reality, and I think that that's consistent with the notion of agential reality that I'm putting forward, but the reason why I use the adjective agential is because I think that there has to be accountability and responsibility for the fact that agency has a place in terms of the reality that we create in the process of answering certain questions or not asking certain questions and so on.
I'm really curious about that. I'd love to, for you to expand on that, because creativity comes out of this playfulness also. And you were talking about the playfulness with fractals and the playfulness within mathematics. And when does this responsibility, this agential to call, come into it? And that's a very difficult question to know how you're, I mean, you can't, if you have tripped onto something and then find that that's something that may not be beneficial from your viewpoint to society, number one, it's only one viewpoint. And number two, somebody else certainly will come along later and find it again. And
yeah, I think that I can't give any global answer to that. A person has to be answered on a case-by-case basis, but I think that there has to be, I think, that there's an obligation on us to ask ourselves critical questions about our project. And that doesn't forbid play, by the way. I mean, on one hand, I want to counter a feeling of play that's an irresponsible sense of play. That is, I don't want physicists to go around and say, oh, it's just all a big game and isn't this fun, and I don't have to be responsible for the world. Yeah, well, this kind of mentality that Feynman said that he got permission from von Neumann during the Los Alamos project, that's a sense of play that I just can't live with. I think it's very irresponsible. On the other hand, I think that play is a very important part of asking good questions. But
maybe even
it has
the answers.
Yeah. Yeah.
It's a great solution. I just have no idea how you frame it.
I just think that play has to be responsible play. I have a 14-month-old, and we have a great time playing, but I think I have to be responsible about the way in which we play together. And, you know, I think, I guess, on a larger social scale, I think that that's what's entailed, is that it's not just a game. People's lives are at stake, the planet's at stake, other beings are at stake, and I think that there's way in which, when I talk about reality, I'm asking constantly, as knowers, what our stakes are. I mean, I just think.
Wondering in society what constructs now are passing that down. I mean, we got the old religious concepts that they used to do it, and I wonder what other social constructs are passing down, saying this is how we want you to be responsible, without being dictatorial, without cutting out the possibility of new findings.
I think that's a really important.
Yeah,
that's something.
Missing.
Yeah, I think that is what we're missing.
Yeah, and that's evident everywhere.
Yeah, right. Right now, it seems like funding for research is one thing that tells us what to do research on. I mean, it's not. And who decides that? Well, some group of people in Washington, and do they think very hard about it? I'm not sure. Change their minds.
Yeah. Do you know that science always follows cause and effect, or like the government has a power or whichever way the policy is going, but that generally takes which way that the science is going to go and what that research is going to go in. You know, like certain topics are being kind of hot, or
research and science does not get done in a vacuum, and there are certain people in the physics community who have become spokespersons for the physics community and statesmen of sorts. And in fact, just speak right now about physics, which is that since the establishment of physics as a profession in the U.S., it's been very tied to the military. it's been very much a part of getting funding through war efforts as part of justification for its projects. And as a result of its participation in the Manhattan Project, it was a very large-scale project. The physicists had to get to know Washington and its workings in order to carry that off. And as a result, they've had their tentacles in there for a long time, and actually what just happened recently was quite profound, and it's going to have effects in the physics community that will be interesting to see. For the first time, since the Manhattan Project, physicists have been told no. That was with the superconducting supercollider. That was the first time. That was an $11 billion project, and I don't have a cold. So there were, you know, that's the scale of money, though, that actually, I mean, people were getting hundreds of millions of dollars like that for certain projects. So while I want to say that there is a relationship about the way in which the government or industries or whatever dictate the projects that science do, I also want to bring in this other, I totally agree with that, I think I want to bring in this other dimension as well about how physicists have had a big party for so long in terms of the ways in which they have gotten to control what they think is important for doing. But I must say that that's at the expense of other physicists who think that totally different types of projects are important, and they have not been able to get funded. Yeah. Well, it's like Amy said, it's the people who sit there on granting, on funding grants and oversee them and decide who gets funding and who doesn't. And those are the people who are asked to be on those. And why are they asked to be on them? Because they're thought to be well-placed in the field. And how did they get to be that? Well, somebody decided they deserve tenure rather than somebody else. I mean, it's a whole thing.
So, but are there, that actually raises a real interesting question in my mind. Are there physicists or mathematicians who can operate separate from the establishment, like there are artists who can, I mean, I think there was one who died, that man recently
streamed.
Was it?
Paul Erdős.
Yes, yeah, who never had a home, and just simply was, I mean, he fascinated me. The story of him fascinated me.
Well, he's pretty rare.
Yeah, because he, does anybody know about him, that he was, you should talk about him more than I should, because you know more about him.
He was extremely prolific. He must have written, you know, 1,000 papers or something. And this guy didn't have a home, he just lived with friends. He'd go around the world and
visit research people. Important?
Pardon me?
Was his research important?
Yeah, I guess it's hard. Now I don't know what's important anymore.
Yeah.
Good. He didn't answer real questions about animals in the world. His field was number theory.
Mm-hmm.
So he asked kinds of questions like, let's see, you drive up to a McDonald's and you have, they have a 6-piece chicken McNuggets and a 9-piece and a 24-piece. What are all the numbers of McNuggets pieces you can get? Like, you can't get 3, right? Start at 6, can you? No. Like that. What are all the numbers that you can't get? So those are the kind. Is that important? I don't know. He liked those kinds of problems, like puzzles, number theory problems. But they might be important. But anyway, he was certainly important in mathematics, and that he proved lots of theorems and wrote lots of papers. And he didn't have a home. He didn't belong to any university. But he was so well respected that he was welcome everywhere. And the other thing he did, which is unique, he offered money to people if they'd solve a problem. Anyone, you know. There were $100 problems, $10 problems. He didn't have a job, so he didn't have money, but other people would give money. It's so bizarre.
It's wonderful. Yeah, I mean, it's almost like a...
But he's sort of the one case I can think of.
Yeah. What about in physics? Are there people that you said yes? Or people that operate outside the establishment that are doing interesting or important work.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Yeah, I mean, they, have different kinds of support networks, mm-hmm. but they're not getting, you know, traditional sources of mm-hmm. funding or whatever.
What kind of support networks are they? What kind of work are they doing?
Well, people who are at universities who can survive without grants, who are mm-hmm. fortunate enough to have a position where they're getting mm-hmm. paid to teach or whatever, and they don't have to bring in their own funding.
Mm-hmm.
There are people who work in industry who have more freedom than some other places in industry and things like that.
Mm-hmm.
So, and there are certainly people who do work that's unpopular at any given moment of time. David Bohm is somebody who comes to my mind as somebody who was basically, in some ways, did incredible work at physics, but was banished from the physics community for being a Marxist and a kind of out-Marxist during the McCarthy era, and was banished
really?
From...
I didn't know that.
Yeah, was banished from the U.S., and his work on quantum theory was consciously related to his political commitments as a Marxist.
Mm-hmm. I didn't realize. I didn't realize.
Yeah, people basically ignored his work during his lifetime, and now that he died a few years ago, it's all of a sudden becoming popular.
It seems like very important work. Yeah. I mean, I'm wondering. There's this model in my head that let me try out it. That I'm sort of making because it seems to me, I mean, I think about, you know, you say, well, I don't know what's important, and you're talking about doing this number theory and doing these very abstract questions. The model that comes to mind in my own head is the art making model that I'm familiar with in my own experiences, which is where I work in the studio in this very playful, very abstract way where I don't know. I mean, I'm in a certain way, I'm funding my own pure research, and that there's questions that come out, that there's objects that come out of that play, and then questions that come out of that play, and then not only objects which form that kind of some kind of vision of that play, but then activities that happen that are also social activities, that are activities of being a citizen as well as activities that are being an artist, that kind of follow out of this strange, compacted battery that happens in the studio where I never know. I mean, it's like free fall. It's like walking in space. And I'm wondering if that's a model that makes sense at all to any of you, or if it just seems completely nonsensical.
It makes sense.
Yes.
Yeah, sure.
But it also goes against what you were saying, Karen, about playing with responsibility.
Mm-hmm.
You have to look outside of your play
mm-hmm.
to know if it's responsible or not.
But then I think you look at the consequences of the play. I mean, I think you have to be able to play in a certain way.
Mm-hmm.
But then you have to be aware of the consequences of that play.
I think they're two separate acts. I don't think so,
because I think you also inform the being. I mean, I think that this is not I'm not an abstract being. I'm a being that I load with certain kinds of information and certain kinds of reading and certain kinds of experiences and certain, you know, and charge that being with certain, with you know, the necessity to be as aware, as, you know, as open, as to pay as much attention. So I'm trying to load the machine, in a sense, with,
yeah.
I mean, I don't know, that's the way I would, I mean, maybe.
But I think there's a, sorry.
There's a difference between, you know, artists and the physicists stepping outside, you know, in this institution to be able to create work. Like, you know, for an artist, I mean, your art school is so much part of
doesn't depend upon getting your hands on equipment of any kind. But I'm a theorist, and my work I do either on computers or with paper and pencil.
Can you know yourself on that? To be able to go after, you know, different ideas as opposed to the ones that are kind of laid out in, you know,
said you did in a way. I mean, it seems to me that, that's in a sense when you talk about moving from quarks to quantum theory, in a sense that that is a conscientious move like that, a move outside the established. I don't know. I mean, I'm speaking for you.
The kinds of questions that I'm asking right now are still outside of the mainstream, I guess, in a way. Certainly, you could have lots of physicists sitting in this chair who wouldn't say any of the kinds of things that I'm saying and who probably want to drag me out of the room. I think that there's a way in which my work is certainly influenced by the institution itself, and probably I would imagine that's similar for artists who work outside of the institution as well, that there's never an outside totally. In a sense.
Because nobody's outside. I mean, it's back to the observer. We're never completely outside. I mean, we're always within a multiple contexts, mm-hmm. multiple where we're always experiencing it in multiple ways.
Mm-hmm. I mean, there's a shared history. There's a certain education. There's a certain way of approaching problems or whatever that makes it hard. That I think that you bring with you, even as a maverick. And I think that that's got to be true with the way that scientists who are mavericks do their work, too. That is, I was trained as a physicist, and I have certain ways of thinking about certain problems that I can't ever, like, totally remove from my... This goes back to what Sheila was talking about in the beginning, is that I have this particular framework, which is historically, culturally, and otherwise situated... But I still can, like the maverick artist or whatever, I guess in different ways, I don't have to stick with the whole, I don't have to buy the whole thing, the whole package. And I can, within certain constraints about the ways in which I think about things, I can ask myself questions that I don't get funding for.
That's what I think is kind of interesting about this whole idea of scientists talking about reality. Because it seems like, you know, all the laws and everything that you've learned, you know, through school, is that your reality is already constructed for you. That, I don't know if it is, but you gotta understand what I'm saying. It's like, you know, all the laws basically, all the rules of physics are basically telling you what reality is, you know, what reality is.
It feels that way when you're in school, right? Is that what you're saying?
Well,
yeah. I mean, it felt that way to me when I was studying in physics.
Well, yeah,
it's just,
I mean,
the way it is.
All of us are, you know, are culturally informed,
right.
You know, socially informed, means we constantly.
But you can pick and choose. I mean, you do get socialized in certain ways, and there are certain ways, subconsciously or whatever, that you're going to not examine critically, and you're going to be influenced by those, and there are other things that come to the surface that you can pick and choose about. Do you agree?
Yeah, I agree. But I think about that in relationship to the conversation, just the whole idea of reality. Because when you say reality, it's almost saying that we all have to, you know, talk about. You know, we all have to find some of them.
Well, I think that's certainly the Newtonian view of reality. That there's just the way the world is, and that if you do good physics, then you find out the way that one world is, that reality that exists outside of human beings. That becomes the objective of doing science, is to discover that which is outside of ourselves. And I think that the view that Niels Bohr gives us is one of immersing ourselves in a reality that's always changing. And that has everything to do with knowers.
And would it be
I think Rachel's point is important because I don't think knowers have to be people either.
Mm-hmm.
But I think, I think that there's an active participation in the reality that we create, and it's not like everything that gets said about the world started at the moment of the Big Bang, and then it's just a matter of unfolding the picture from where our eyes, and we all have to deal with that one static kind of reality.
So you think part of the way of changing our perception of reality is changing the way that we perceive it as opposed to us being outside of it?
I think part of the way that we perceive our reality has an influence on reality.
Start to break down language at a certain point.
those are really good questions. Maybe I'll just even forget about what I thought you were saying. There's a sense, I mean, you might ask yourself in this context of the way quantum mechanics talks about an observer-created reality, how anything called science can still be done. And does an observer-created reality mean that the reality is totally subjective? And does it get to be a kind of culturally relativized reality and so on? And even maybe an epistemologically relativistic type of reality? Those are important questions. What Niels Bohr said with respect to this is that the reason why we can still do something that we call science and why we can still communicate with one another is because when I have a particular conceptual framework and I go and act upon that in the world and set up a particular agency of observation, as he calls it, a means of interacting within the world, then I have reference then to that particular apparatus that we could point to. And what he says is that marks are left on bodies. And that is our common reference point for communication, is marks on bodies. So that it's not a matter of somebody can sit there and say, you know, this kind of way in which sometimes my students want to fall into of, I have my reality, you have your reality, and everything else, because I would think that there's no politics in that, ultimately, or anything. And there's no responsibility, certainly.
Or no interconnectedness.
It doesn't sound like that has any, when you say marks are left on bodies, it sounds like you're saying, in effect, that things have consequences.
That's correct.
There's only a consequence that can be observed in the dialogue.
Yet on an individual level, the events are not predictable.
And then the question becomes, why is the mark similar on different bodies? And if the mark is dissimilar, how can we get to do it?
Well, because we have a way of making reference to even compare them to say that they're similar or not similar.
And what are the marks he's talking about? What is he talking about? He's talking about aging, he's talking about...
Well, I mean, talking about it in a much more concrete way. He's talking about the fact that if I want to measure the position of an electron on a screen...
Bodies that way. I was thinking, I was looking around bodies. You're talking
I think it applies to a much larger sense of bodies.
Huh? Yeah.
I think it applies in the much larger sense of bodies, and I really like
that. That's a beautiful statement. It's a beautiful statement.
That way, because... For example, I think that there's a way in which people want to say that because race or gender or sexuality is socially constructed, that therefore it's artificial somehow. But what this says is that with this particular structural framework, that there are real material consequences in our society for being marked in those particular ways, and that just because something is socially constructed doesn't mean that it isn't real.
I don't think that he means that. I think he means that it's the meaning that puts, you know, race or gender or sexuality. I don't think he's saying that, you know, those things are artificial, but, you know, the meaning that we're putting...
Could you speak up, please?
Oh, I'm sorry. It's not saying that race or gender or, you know, sexuality is, or sex is, you know, artificial, but the meaning that we put...
I'm agreeing with you, but I'm saying that there's a way in which when people, I don't know how widespread this is, but certainly in the academy now, people who are saying that other people are talking about social constructivism, that they're somehow taking away from things being real. Mm. And I think that there's also a way in which a certain part of our culture likes to think about the infinitely plastic body again. as being totally a social construct, and that can be molded in any way, shape, or form. And I think that there are material constraints that don't allow for infinite plasticity of bodies. So I agree with you. I mean, I think that it has everything to do with meaning, but that's what Bohr's talking about when he says that we set up a particular conceptual framework which gets embodied or instantiated in a particular physical apparatus to begin with. Because that's what it's all about, is that the meaning doesn't exist outside of this way of constructing meaning. It doesn't exist out there in a world independently of us human beings. But once we have that meaning, it has real material consequences.
And the meaning is between us. The meaning is not...
The meaning doesn't belong to the thing.
That's right. And I think that's important in terms of what you're asking, because I think that the meaning is co-constructed in a sense.
That's right.
And that's... You've been... Come on.
So I just... I don't know that this is, it relates exactly to what you were talking about, but in my own sphere, where I'm teaching computer graphics to a class of 24,